Good afternoon, members. We've formed a quorum. It is also time to start, so I'll call the meeting to order. At this moment, I'll invite the administration to join us. We have three items on the agenda. First of all, we'll talk about the anti-epidemic efforts and roles that may be performed by Chinese medicine practitioners in the handling of the COVID-19 epidemic. We have scheduled up to 5:10 p.m. for this topic. Dr. Choi Tae-yi and his team will join us in the discussion. First of all, I'll give the floor to the administration for a brief introduction, and then the floor will be open to members for questions. All right. If you've settled down, then I will invite Dr. Choi, Undersecretary, to walk us through the paper briefly. Thank you, Chair. Well, first of all, we talk about the anti-epidemic efforts and roles that may be performed by CMPs in the handling of the COVID-19 epidemic. Well, we understand that Chinese medicine is part of the healthcare system in Hong Kong, so CMPs do play a role in handling of COVID-19 epidemic. All the time, we have had close liaison with the CM sector, so that the CMPs know about the latest information and how they can sort of act as gatekeepers. Well, under the CM Development Fund, we have got a new development. That is, we do include novel coronavirus epidemic-related projects, and we have also got the CM Clinic Improvement Funding Scheme, so that we can deal with the relevant applications. We are getting applications from the sector, and then we are actively vetting the applications. And then as a first step to enhance the role of the CMPs, on the 24th of April, we have already introduced the Special Chinese Medicine Outpatient Program, so as to provide free CM outpatient rehabilitation service to discharged persons who have received COVID-19 treatment. It will be implemented with the first phase at the Tai Po District CMC. It will be rolled out to other CM clinics. Well, CMPs are working at the front line and they serve the public. So, in fact, for some of the confirmed patients, they have had visits to the CMPs. It is necessary to step up their PPEs at their clinics, and therefore earlier on, the administration through the alliance involving CMPs donated a batch of surgical masks to the CMPs so as to carry out the joint efforts against the epidemic. I would like to pause here. That's all from me in relation to the introduction. Members, any questions? Mr. Xu Ka-chun and then Dr. K.K. Kwok, followed by me, Mr. Xu. Well, we don't have a lot of members here, so I'll say that 5 minutes each. Thank you. According to paragraph 9, as far as the treatment of COVID-19 is concerned, well, CMPs will be providing free CM outpatient rehabilitation service to the discharged persons, and yet they would not be joining the Western medicine practitioners to treat the patients at the front line. Baptist Yu, in June 2003, during the year when he had SARS, submitted a paper to the relevant expert committee saying that collaboration between the CM and the USM helped the patients, and it was given recognition by the WHO experts. At that time, two experts from the mainland were invited to help. In other words, we are not able to ride on the synergy. In paragraph 7, it is said that currently, it will be difficult to allow the CMPs to provide treatment services to patients in public hospitals. That said, they will continue to explore the matter and make timely arrangements as necessary. When will it be done? 17 years have passed since 2003. Why haven't you referred to the collaboration between CM and WM as practice on the mainland? Are you going to invite the CMPs to provide clinical treatment to the confirmed patients in hospitals immediately? And then for paragraph 9, it is said that 10 free CM general consultations within 6 months from the discharge date of the patients will be provided. But then for CM, it takes a longer time. Are you going to provide more outpatient consultations to the discharged patients? Thank you. Dr. Choi, when it comes to the treatment, prevention and rehabilitation of diseases, different medical or healthcare workers have different roles to play, and they can be coordinated. Now, for COVID-19, as far as the virus as well as the disease are concerned, it is entirely something new to us regarding its structures, its features, the treatment protocol, etc. I think it is true that throughout the world, everybody was trying out different methods, and we were sort of exploring the methods. For our public healthcare system in Hong Kong, currently, when we deal with acute diseases, the predominant role will be played by Western medicine. Diagnosis, treatment are all being sort of dealt with in the same way. And we treat the patients with Western medicines. For the hospital authority, we do run a very vigorous system in relation to the safety side effects, as well as the interaction of different drugs within the Western medicine discipline. And we know that frontline doctors are most concerned about this. We have been relying on the information systems to check whether different kinds of medicines would contradict each other, so as to make sure that doctors won't be prescribing such medicines. Now, given the very novel nature of the disease, now we've been using protease inhibitors as well as the interferons, etc. We have also been using ribavirin. Some of them would generate serious side effects, and they may interact with other drugs. The side effects could be mild, moderate, or serious. That said, since patients are being admitted to isolation wards, all the health workers have to don the relevant PPEs. And therefore, when it comes to the treatment of such acute diseases, I don't think we are in the right time to engage CMPs. My understanding is that during the SARS outbreak, CM did play a role in the convalescence of the SARS patients. So we had a word about this, and we do give recognition to the role of CMPs in the rehabilitation of patients, and that's why we have got this program. Well, time is running out, so I have to give the floor to the second member, Dr. K. Kwok, 5 minutes as well. Undersecretary, a few points to explore with you. First of all, for the Wuhan pneumonia, we're relying on the antiviral medicine. So when it comes to CM and CMPs, what exactly are their roles? That's my first question. Second question is that for the 2 proprietary CMs recommended in the diagnosis treatment protocols and given to us by the National Administration of Traditional CM, namely Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang and Huoxiang Zhengqipian. Have you carried out any vigorous analysis? Sometimes we have been told that usually we have only got the formula, the preparation, but we haven't got anything other than that. In Germany, what they have done is that they have analyzed the chemical composition and they found out about the active ingredient. I want to know whether the same has been done in Hong Kong. Otherwise, for the capsules as well as the huoxiang preparation, it appears to me that they are just like any off-the-shelf medicines, and I don't think they're really helpful. And then some patients have told us that at the time that they were discharged from the hospitals, they were not given the offer that is to have 10 free general consultations. I want to know when they will be notified. It seems that this will be done at many hospitals. Are you going to explain to the patients as to how they can make use of the 10 free general consultations? What is important is that if you want to provide a service, if you want to carry out a research, to do it properly, you need to get the patients together. Currently, we have got 1,040 confirmed cases. Are you going to treat them or follow up on them at one single clinic? Otherwise, if they are going to 8 different clinics throughout the city, it will be difficult to get the answers. Before the Undersecretary answer your questions, let me emphasize one point. Well, it is called COVID-19 and not Wuhan pneumonia. The WHO has already decided on the name. I will urge members not to use Wuhan pneumonia to describe the epidemic. If you continue to use this term, I will rule that you are using unparliamentary language. Well, who made that decision? I believe that, as you can tell from our papers, it's been called COVID-19 disease. Why are you qualified to say that you can rule it as a parliamentary language? I hope members will respect the rules and your status as a lawmaker. Well, this is a point of order. This is because we are being sort of protected here, unless what we are saying is regarded as an insult to a member or a public officer. If I use the term Wuhan pneumonia and if you say that it is offensive, please tell me why. No, it is one about the encephalitis, Japanese encephalitis. Well, it is something very basic. It is a ruling of the chairman. It is not open to discussion. You are being silly. You are mad. Who? If you say that you are, well, tell me who you were referring to. Did you refer to me? Yes, indeed. You must withdraw the remark. I'm not going to do that. You have to go out. The next, Ms. Chen.
Okay, so let.
Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, point of order. The Undersecretary has not responded to Dr. KK Kwok's question, but I have invited him out. Undersecretary, please. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Kwok, for your question. About the first question, the role of Chinese medicine in treating COVID-19. Like I said in the beginning, the disease caused by this virus is very novel. Its characteristics, and how infectious it is, and what about and its effects on organs, the speed of recovery, the survival rates of virus, and so on. Those are very new to us. So in the public health system, we can only assess the virus based on previous respiratory disease like SARS. We took reference and devised of a Western medicine protocol to treat the 1,040 patients. So we don't have time to include to bring in Chinese medicine to clinical uses. So that's the background. I would like to invite Dr. Ng to tell us more about the two drugs given to Hong Kong by the mainland authorities, Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang and Huoxiang Zhenqi Pian, and also about the Chinese medicine rehabilitation plan for our recovered patients. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to explain something. There have been questions about whether there are contemporary medical data and research about the two drugs. When dealing with disease, the logic of Chinese medicine is not completely the same as Western medicine. The mainland has listed these two drugs as drugs capable of treating COVID-19. That's because after looking at the mainland cases, they found the cause for the disease. And then they found drugs, Chinese medicine drugs, which can deal with the cause of disease to treat for treatments. And also there are clinical observations made. Research shows that they are clinically effective. So from the Chinese medicine perspective, if you want to look further into whether there are antiviral effects of these two drugs, there are research concerning Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang. It is effective in inhibiting indirectly the replication of virus in the patient's body. So indirectly, it helps to contain the spread of the disease. So these two drugs are recommended based on Chinese medicine theory, and also they are clinical data to support their efficacy. And even from the Western medicine perspective, there are data to support the use of these two drugs. Ms. Wong, please. As to the special outpatient Chinese medicine outpatient service, we wrote the plan on the 24th of April. The recovered patients will receive a letter and information. They can make a booking, and also they could call our hotline for inquiry. For those recovered patients, in our press release and other electronic information, we have made public a hotline available to these discharged patients. We would send an invitation to these discharged patients so they can attend the follow-up at the outpatient clinics. Next question, please. Ms. Chen. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, I agree with Chairman's ruling, because the WHO has already decided that the virus name should be COVID-19. We are still in the middle of battling the disease. We have an official name, so we don't have to make up another name to mislead people or cause other issues. We should all follow WHO, which is a recognized organization, and follow the official name, COVID-19. Let's focus on how to battle the disease. So, Chairman, I support you for correcting the name of the disease. Undersecretary, we have heard from you that we have been focusing on how Chinese medicine could be used to treat the virus. But I have another perspective. Undersecretary, you said many acute diseases are being treated with Western medicine. We have been focusing on how Chinese medicine and how CMPs can help treat the epidemic. But I'm thinking how we can use Chinese medical practitioners to help alleviate the pressure, the shortage of manpower in Western medicine hospitals. a lot of manpower has been deployed to battle the disease. But actually, we have a manpower study revealing that there is an excess of manpower of CMPs. I'm not asking them to gear up and go into the wards to treat patients, but maybe we can use Chinese medicine to treat chronic disease and other diseases so that the Western medicine medical staff manpower could be freed up to battle the epidemic. Actually, I want to quote an example. This is not the first time I quote this example. I'm talking about the mobile Chinese medicine clinic. We have been liaising and cooperating with our NGO to provide Chinese medicine services with mobile clinic because patients are afraid to go to hospitals to see a doctor, and there is a long queue of waiting in line. So why don't we enlist the help of CMPs to alleviate the pressure at A&EDs and other clinics? We're not necessarily asking the CMPs to go into the hospitals to help treat the patients. We can redeploy the excess Chinese medicine practitioners to help shorten the queue. So that the doctors and nurses at public hospitals will be less stressed. Thank you. For your question. The government has been progressively incorporated the Chinese medicine into our public health system. So we have introduced government-subsidized quotas among the 18 Chinese medicine clinics in terms of Chinese medicine and acupuncture. Of course, we are still at the beginning of measure. And also there are Chinese medical practitioners working in private sectors and with government bodies. So the public are free to enlist Chinese medicine to treat them. For example, a bone setting and also ailments or mild symptoms. Citizens are free to choose Chinese medicine to treat them. So I think that's the role the Chinese medicine is playing. Under Secretary, you mentioned about Chinese medical practitioners in the private sectors. You know, you haven't increased the amount of health voucher for elderly, so there is a $1,000 less for them. Why can't you think out of the box to support public-private partnership? We're not just talking about Western medicine. Maybe we can adopt this model for Chinese medicine as well. Patients can approach NGOs like Port Oil Hospital and Yanzhai Hospital. They all have mobile Chinese medicine clinics. We are being stopped by the housing departments to park the vehicles in the housing estates. Actually, you can apply healthcare vouchers for elderly to be applicable to Chinese medicine. Let's say in Lamshan Estates, many elderly have the problem of hypertension. They are afraid to go to the public hospital, but they want to use the service at the mobile clinic. But you are not increasing the amount of healthcare voucher for the elderly. Thank you, member, for your view. We will further look into that. Mr. Xiu Gafai. Thank you, Chairman. About the epidemic, in paragraph 6 in the paper, it says that the National Administration of Traditional Chinese Medicine had presented the government with two proprietary Chinese medicines recommended in the diagnosis and treatment protocols for novel coronavirus pneumonia, namely the Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang and Huo Xiang Zhen Qi Pian. From the industry, many friends in the industry told me that they have given away these drugs for free to those in need. Now, the epidemic is reaching a more stable phase. We have zero new local infection for 15 days. So we thank you for your efforts. We also we are very grateful for the National Administration of Traditional Chinese Medicine to help us in this this time. In paragraph 9, the hospital authority is going to launch, or rather has launched, the special Chinese medicine outpatient program in the Chinese medicine clinic on the 24th April. Can you tell me more about this service? Under Secretary, please. I will invite Ms. Wong to give us more details. Thank you, Member, for your question. About the special Chinese medicine outpatient program, for those COVID-19 patients discharged, we're going to provide them with Chinese medicine follow-up service. In February, we have established an expert panel with three universities with Chinese medicine schools on how we can help convalescents after patients have recovered from COVID-19. So within 6 months of discharge, they're going to be provided with 10 free-of-charge Chinese medicine follow-up service with 5 doses provided. We're going to look at the patient's needs based on evidence-based science and to provide prescription for the patient. It is all on a voluntary basis. Patients can decide whether they will join the program after looking at the information. So for this type of COVID-19 recovered patients, they can actually choose to join your program or attend Western medicine follow-ups. So have you carried out any study on the efficacy of the follow-up? What would be the benefits of attending this kind of follow-up? Actually, there are Western medicine follow-ups available. So like I said, Chinese medicine follow-up is on a voluntary basis. The patients can decide it on their own. We are actively studying and gathering data from the follow-up, from this follow-up program, so as to improve the arrangements of bringing in Chinese medicine into follow-up services. A question for the Undersecretary. Now we have zero new infection for 15 days. So many patients have been treated and discharged. So did we have any case of having to return to the hospital because they show symptoms again?
What do you mean they have to come back? No, they were confirmed to have recovered, but then after being discharged for a few days, it seems that they were tested and they were tested positive again. So I think you're talking about the relapse. That is, patients have recovered, but then upon further testing, it was found that the RNA of the virus was still present. Well, on different occasions, experts have already explained the matter. It could be that the immune system has not cleared all the virus. So even for the inactive virus, since the RNA test is very sensitive, the virus was still detected. But then it is no longer infectious, and the treatment process has ended. And so for this group of patients, first of all, there aren't too many of them. And second, as far as the infectivity is concerned, I don't think it is a great concern. Can I have a brief follow-up? Yes, please. Well, for this group of patients who have recovered, if it is found that they still have some virus in their bodies, do you know whether it will be infectious? So far, we haven't got such information. Next, Mrs. Regina Yip. I'm also interested in the CM drugs donated by the National Administration. Well, I want to know if you know the ingredients. Is it going to inhibit or suppress the disease, or whether it helps with the recovery of the patients? Do you have any clinical information? Thank you. Maybe Mr. Ng or Dr. Ng can give you the details in relation to the two proprietary CMs given to us by the National Administration, the ingredients as well as the efficacy. Dr. Ng, just now the member would like to know about the ingredients. Just now I tried to explain. When it comes to Chinese medicine, when we apply the drugs, it is from the perspective of traditional CM, where we are aware of the Chinese herbal medicine. As to the chemical substances or the molecules, well, I don't think I've got the information with me. And then after the herbs have been boiled and prepared, you will have a spectrum of the substances, but I haven't got such information. But in the absence of that, it doesn't prevent us from using the drug, and it won't affect its safety. I hope you can understand this point. In CM, when we administer a drug, we don't base it on the chemical substances. Rather, it is based on the CMP's understanding of the substances, and we also bear in mind the individual circumstances of patients. Of course, we've got clinical research and we know the effects of such drugs. So as far as the ingredients are concerned, we do know what ingredients are involved. But then as to the actual breakdown at the molecular level, I believe that we do have the information, but I haven't got it with me. Chairman, I think over the past decade or two, we've given a lot of money to the universities to spend on R&D. I think at CUHK, they have also got programs on the toxicology of the CM. I think the government has spent a lot of money on the universities, right? Well, from Lianhua, Qingwen Jiaonang, as an example, well, the fellows of the academy led the research team, so surely they know the ingredients. Just now, I was emphasizing that when the drugs were administered to the patients, our approach started with the perspective of the CM. We have also got literature about the ingredients of such drugs. You talk about the research in Hong Kong. I'm sure it is going to be helpful. Well, whether it is for the sake of suppression or assistance in the recovery, well, for Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang, it can suppress or inhibit the replication of the viral cells in the body. From the Chinese medicine's perspective, for Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang, we say that, well, if a patient has got this attack from the outside by the virus, you need a force to help with the expulsion of the virus. We also need some assistance to treat the patient so as to speed up the recovery and ease the symptoms. So that's sort of the outcome that we're looking at. So whether it is suppression or supporting the recovery, it depends on whether it is an appropriate administration. What about Huoxiang Zhengqipian? Well, for Lianhua, it's for expelling the virus. For Huoxiang, it is more about the theory of dispelling the wetness. Well, I understand that when we have a COVID-19 patient, if he's suffering from diarrhea, etc., then by using this drug, we can ease the symptoms. And if he has got a low-grade fever, that can also be modified or moderated. Mrs. Regina Yip, were you interested? Just now, Mrs. Regina Yip talked about the clinical outcome. Is it on the mainland or in Hong Kong? It's on the mainland, because in Hong Kong, we haven't got the data concerning the use of such drugs by our CMPs in Hong Kong. Well, here we are talking about the use of CM in the handling of COVID-19 epidemic. I think we are sort of having a regression. I think since the outbreak up to the 24th of April, the administration hasn't done anything at all in relation to the role of the CMPs. I think it would have been a very difficult time for the author of this paper, for Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonan, as well as the Huoxiang Zheng Qipian. I think they were offered to the COVID-19 patients, but then the government didn't give them to the patients. And in fact, for those confined to the quarantine centers and for people confined to home under the quarantine orders, they were not allowed, they were not given access to such drugs. Is this true? For the National Administration of Traditional CM, did they specify who should be given the drugs, the general public or the COVID-19 patients? If we are to give out the drugs in this way, is it against the original idea of the donor? And then my second question is, when it comes to the cooperation with the CMPs, I think your emphasis is on prevention, or if it is found that the infection has been confirmed, what should be done? In other words, you haven't applied CM in the treatment of COVID-19. Now, for Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonan and the Huoxiang Zheng Qipian, we want to know about the clinical outcome. It appears to me that you have a bias. You assume that there will be side effects and it would clash with Western medicine. But then on the mainland, the experience is that 91% of the patients were given Chinese medicine. And at a clinical level, 90% of the cases benefited from the use of CM. But what about the Hong Kong government? It appears that you're still being very conservative. You're too afraid of the possible side effects. So are you excluding CM in the treatment protocol? Rather, you would only make use of it when it comes to prevention. And then for the development fund, you would only allow the clinics to use the money to buy certain equipments and supplies. It goes against our objective. And when compared with the case of SARS in 2003, to me, it is a regression. So please tell us why you are preventing the CMPs from playing a role. Under Secretary, well, for our healthcare system, be it the public or the private sectors, and whether we're talking about Western medicine or Chinese medicine, well, I think they have a common role in this outbreak. In other words, they will be exposed to patients with some initial symptoms, like a slight fever, some respiratory symptoms, etc. For those who are serious, they would have gone to the A&E departments. The outbreak emerged at a time when winter was sort of towards its end. And so this also the time when we used to have a lot of flu patients. So for practitioners of both Western medicine and Chinese medicine, they needed awareness and they required the information and they needed the equipment so as to help them to control the infection. For treatment, as I have pointed out at the beginning, globally speaking, it was a novel disease. and there were a lot of new features. And in fact, all along, in our public healthcare system, acute patients are treated by Western medicine doctors. And when it comes to the guidelines for the prescription of drugs, we have to work within the regulatory framework. So if you want to try a new drug on patients, there are just too many safety concerns, and therefore we have to deal with it in a very cautious manner. For the Lianhua Qingwen Jiaonang, did they specify who should receive the donated drugs? Maybe Dr. Ng can elaborate on this. Dr. Ng, do you know? Or should I recap the question for you? Yes, I know the question. Let me try to elaborate. Just now, mention was made about the two drugs. They were given to us by the National Administration of Traditional CM. My understanding is that it's up to the Hong Kong SAR government to decide what is best in relation to the arrangements. For CMPs, CMPs should guide the use of the Chinese medicines. Now, we want to know how the patients or how the public can have the relevant knowledge instead of just getting it off the shelf. We are lucky to have the help of the Alliance, and they've set up a hotline so that for citizens who have been given the drugs can call them and can call the hotline so as to find out about the instructions to use the drugs. I think in this way it is safe and it is a proper usage of the drugs. So that's how we have dealt with the proprietary CMs offered to us by the National Administration. So, of course, it is very good that the CM industry has been helping out. Now, you have got a batch of drugs donated to you. Well, they are registered proprietary CMs, and members of the public can get it in the market. It's only it was possible that they ran out of stock. Now, there were people who needed it, and yet they were not able to have it. Now, for the quarantine centers, I think it would have been much better if you've got CMPs, and then the CMPs would instruct the patients or the confinees how to use the drugs. That's much better than giving it out free of charge to anybody in the society. Now, for the roles played by the CMPs, well, it is said that the hospital authority and the government have adopted an open attitude. But I think on this occasion, the CMPs have been missed out. In fact, it is a very good opportunity for the CMPs to study the matter and try the drugs. So we've missed the opportunity to try the drugs. So to me, I believe that while healthcare workers were having a hard time, CMPs were not allowed to play a role, and it is most regrettable. If you haven't got other questions, then we can move on to the second discussion item.
Under Secretary, please. Item 2. Thank you, Chairman. It's about government-subsidized Chinese medicine outpatient services and integrated Chinese Western medicine inpatient services. So we invite Ms. Ravenna Wong, Chief Chinese Medicine Department, to take us through the paper. Thank you, Chairman. The paper aims to brief members the implementation of government-subsidized Chinese medicine services starting from the 1st of March 2020, including in the 18 Chinese medicine clinics come training and research at district level. In the 2018 policy address, it was mentioned that we would develop Chinese medicine service to the public as a whole. We have rolled out 620,000 attendance quota, including Chinese medicine, with acupuncture and bone setting trainer services newly included. The charge each time is $120 for those CSSA recipients and also recipients of the higher old age living allowance, age 75 or above. The fee will be exempted completely. In our Chinese medicine clinic cum training center, we have also stepped up our training efforts. So since the 1st of March, we have stepped up our efforts on training, especially for the 3 years on-the-job training for Chinese medical practitioners and trainees. We have provided a new progressive training curriculum for them. We have opened a position of tutoring for the trainees, and the post is going to be fully subsidized. We are still developing integrated Chinese Western medicine inpatient services. In March 2020, for the daily fees of $200 are required to be paid by the inpatients, it is lower to $120. And we are going to base on the evaluation study of the pilot programs as a reference to devise the future developments of integrated Chinese Western medicine services. Mr. Xu Gafai, I welcome this paper. The government is subsidizing 620 attendance quota in the 18 districts. For those over 75 years of age, the fees will even be exempted. So, of course, that is most welcomed. My first question is, how are you going to tell the public you have this service in place, including an exemption of fees for those aged 75 or above? That's the first question. Secondly, in paragraph 9, it is mentioned that the remuneration package for the 415 registered Chinese medical patients, medical practitioners, in the financial year of 2019-20, the salaries will be not less than $45,000. And for those CMP trainees, the salaries will be not less than $22,000. Actually, can we raise the amount a bit? There's a great discrepancy between the remuneration package for CMPs and Western medicine practitioners, especially for those CMP trainees. How many years have they spent on studying Chinese medicine? Ms. Wong, thank you, member, for your question. About publicity, in March, we were trying to roll out the scheme as soon as possible to the public, but we have been hit by the epidemic. Our publicity concentrated on the clinic itself and also on our media like our website and Facebook. And also we have informed the district councillors. We are going to step up the publicity efforts progressively so that more people will know about our service. About remuneration package, as the honorary member said, in the past 7 years, we have been increasing recurrent subsidies to the clinics to raise the salaries for the Chinese medicine practitioners. For CMP trainees, we are talking about those graduated Chinese medicine practitioners with a license. They have passed the examination. But we would like to provide more clinical training to these CMP trainees. So we have included a new program of clinical training mentored by senior Chinese medicine practitioners. So after getting a license, we are talking about the first 3 years of practice of CMP trainees. And for CMPs we are talking about those with 4 years of practical experiences. What about those students, doctors, who are, or rather, interns at the Western medicine hospitals? What are their salaries? I don't have the information right now. The CMP trainees you mentioned, actually, they have completed their Chinese medicine degrees, and they have already got a license. But it seems that the remuneration package of not less than $22,000 is a little bit on the low side. They already have the license, and they have finished their degree. How did you come up with this this amount? In our 18 districts clinics, the hiring of Chinese medicine practitioners will be handled by the NGO responsible for operating the clinics. So for the first year of practice of these CMP trainees, 80% of the time will be spent on training, include mentorship, consultation, and also trainings. If they do not take these trainings, can they come out to practice on their own after getting a license? Well, under the current law, they can. So they can come out to practice. By working at your clinics, they are just trying to work with more senior CMPs. The remuneration of $22,000, would the HA consider raising the remuneration? We are talking about 3 years of such a salary. How much time does a CMP needs to get a license? They need 6 years of training before getting a license. Well, 6 years, Chairman, I think that's unreasonable. You spend 6 years to get a license, and then you have to endure the salary of $22,000 for 3 years. Actually, even after 3 years, the salary is not that high. But if you really want to develop Chinese medicine, well, the doctors need to eat as well. So I think $22,000 is rather low. Now it's my turn. Also about remuneration. I've looked up the salary for a new kindergarten teacher. The salary is $21,686. For a CMP, the salary is $22,000. So for a CMP with a license with under 3 years of experience, actually the salary is similar to that of kindergarten teachers. Well, actually, we have mentioned this concern numerous times. We were hoping to see some improvements, but it seems that there's none. A CMP with a license is being paid such a petty sum. Now, what about the salary for a Chinese medicine student intern? The salary would be even lower. For a Chinese medicine practitioners with more than 3 years of experience, they have $35,000. But for a nurse, for a Western medicine nurse, the remuneration range from $31,000 to $50,000. So that means that a Chinese medicine practitioners with more than 3 years of experience, the salary would be similar to a nurse. For someone who has studied for 6 years and then who spends a lot of effort in passing the exam, working in a government-subsidized organization, they are only paid poorly. So would the government consider revising the remuneration package? Because this directly relates to whether someone would choose to study Chinese medicine at all. We are talking about doctors helping others. We need talents to study 6 years and then get a license to help people. We should pay more. We should pay these people more. Can anyone answer me how this salary level is set? Thank you, Chairman. Actually, in the paper, it says the government is going to allocate more resources into the clinics, and also more recurrence expenditure will be spent on improving the prospects of Chinese medicine practitioners, as well as to help the development of Chinese medicine. But looking back at the developments of the 18 Chinese medicine clinics until we have this revised remuneration package. In between the time the remuneration package was decided by the operating NGOs, so the range may be quite large, because different organizations would set the remuneration level differently. Since the government has stepped up subsidizing the clinics and programs, now the government has a say about the minimum wage. This is something new, a new standard set for the 18 Chinese medicine clinics. Chairman, you mentioned that for Chinese medicine practitioners with more than 3 years of experience, they get $35,000. Actually, that is just the minimum pay. The pay can be higher than that. So we will constantly review whether there are room for adjustments. We will look at the scale, surfaces, and scope of study when the Chinese medicine hospital is set up. So we will make timely adjustments. Now, the government is buying 620,000 attendance quota from these 18 clinics. So this is something new. Actually, in the past several years, the members in our subcommittee have been saying that the CMPs in Hong Kong are getting a low pay. So why can't we adjust the salaries using this opportunity? Because the 18 clinics will serve as a reference. If you are paying them so poorly, those CMPs working in the private sectors will be even paid more poorly. Can you provide us with a pay scale? Well, we have been nurturing a lot of Western medicine doctors, and we are going to have Chinese medicine hospital soon. So why can't you devise a pay scale so that the CMPs can see the prospect? Thank you, Chairman. On the 1st of December 2018, the remuneration has been adjusted. We can use that as a starting point to review the salary level. Well, will there be a review every year or every 2 years? Well, we will study about it. Any other questions from members? No. Mr. Xu Gafai, any questions? If not, we are going to move on to the next item.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is about the development of Chinese Medicine Hospital. I would like to defer to Dr. Chen Huilun, who is the project director. Please give him the floor. Please switch on the mic. Well, I would like to brief you on the development of the Chinese Medicine Hospital. Well, we are working on two fronts. First of all, we are now drawing up the tender document. We'd like to get a non-profit-making operator to run the hospital. At the same time, we are working on the construction of the CMH. We hope that by phases, we can commission the hospital in 2025. We would like to promote the development of Chinese medicine. It will be a change driver. It will also help us in training, education, research, collaboration, and creating health values. First of all, medical services. The CMH will provide predominantly CM clinical services. There will also be collaboration between CM and WM. And there will be six specialties, and there will be special disease models for the training and education. Well, currently, we've got three universities running schools of Chinese medicine. So we will become the training platform for the CM undergraduate students. It will also become the research platform for graduates of CM. When it comes to research and development, we will become a high-grade clinical research platform. We will also have a testing center, and we have got two phases of testing so that we can test the proprietary Chinese medicines, and we have a have the global market in mind. For us to promote Chinese medicine, we need to collaborate with the industry. In other words, we are going to provide a large number of channels so that the CMPs and the CM practitioners or the stakeholders can collaborate with the CMH. And then for the creation of health values, we will promote the application of CM. We will enhance public awareness of CM, and we'll also promote the health values of CM services. We hope that once the hospital has been commissioned, it will become a landmark in our development. Currently, we haven't got the clinical platform, and let's hope that the CMH will fill this gap. All right, members, any questions? Mrs. Shukafai. Thank you, Chair. According to the Bureau, you have got a timetable, but can you be more exact about the timetable as to when it will be commissioned and comes into operation? Thank you. If everything goes smoothly, we need to carry out the construction, but before that, we need to go to the Public Works Subcommittee as well as the Finance Committee to go through the procedures. If it works out smoothly, it will be in 2024 that the hospital will be commissioned by phases. 2024? I think last time the information I got was that the operation will be carried out by an NGO. What about the tendering outcome? Do you know who's the operator? We, in the first phase, pre-qualified some tenderers. Just last week, we announced the outcome. Four non-profit-making organizations have been included in the second round. That is, they have been pre-qualified. It is hoped that towards the end of this year, we're able to select one of the non-profit-making organizations with the award, with the contract being awarded next year. For the four organizations, is the information made public or is it still being kept confidential? Well, in fact, we have issued a press release. Which four? Yan Oi Tong, Tonghua Group of Hospitals, Hong Kong Baptist University, and Port Oi Hospital. Do they have to tell you how much money they are going to inject into the project? Well, we are talking about pre-qualification. So we are talking about the operational framework. As to the sort of details you referred to, probably that would be something we would be interested in the second round. But then we are in the course of drafting the details. It's not right for me to divulge the information. Well, I think there was an argument as to whether there would be government subsidy or whether it should be self-financing. If it is self-financing, then you would charge a higher level of fees. And then for R&D, that may be inhibited if it is to be run on a self-financing basis. If you get government subsidies, then the fees that patients pay will be lower and it will be more facilitating the R&D. No, it won't be operated on a self-financing basis. The government's financial commitment is quite substantial. The government is going to pay for the construction. All the equipment, facilities and information systems will be funded by the government. And then more than half of the services will be in the form of government-subsidized services. In other words, the government is going to sort of reimburse the cost. So as far as the financial commitment of the government is concerned, I think it is quite substantial. Do we have to consult the district council? Well, it's our plan to go to the district council next week. Which district council? Sai Kung. Because it is located in Chang Kwan O. Just one round of consultation, yes, but of course it depends on the progress. Good luck with you. Earlier on, we have asked this question. You're going to get an NGO to run the CMH. I think it shows that still the government doesn't want to regard it as the mainstream of the public healthcare system. It would just leave it in the hands of an NGO. Of course, it has got the beauty of being flexible. But what about the outcome? Now, for the 18 CM clinics, they have a say on the pay for the CMPs. So for the CMH, what is the role of the government? Regulator, or you are picking up the bill, you are going to provide a subsidy? What about quality assurance? What can you do if the quality is a problem? It would only be in the year 2021-2022 that you will go to the PwC. You know that the agendas have been blocked both at the PwC as well as the FC meetings. And yet you're saying that by 2024, you will be commissioning the hospital by phases. Can we really get it in 2 years' time? But then it was first proposed in 2014, so it will take us 10 years. Should there be a delay of a few years, it will be more than 15 years before we get our first CMH. So I want to know to what extent then can the government control the progress. Let me answer the question. Well, it is going to be a public-private collaboration project. Well, let me put it this way. For this CMH, more than half of the medical services will be subsidized by the government. So even though it is not going to be a hospital under the hospital authority, but then the services that it is going to offer will mainly be public and subsidized services. At the same time, we have market-oriented services. We have to be so because currently the CM service is in the community. If we want to promote the development of CM, we have to have interaction with the CMPs in the private market. So when we have the market-oriented services as well, training, R&D, technology transfer, etc., will be facilitated. In other words, the current setup will tie in with the development of CM in the private market. Now, first of all, we are going to have a tendering exercise, and then there will be a contract. The government's role will be managing the contract. At the same time, the government is buying the service. The government is subsidizing the service. So the government will have a say in relation to R&D, service provision, etc. And should there be any sort of policies being adopted by the government, they have to be implemented at the same age. We will also be a regulator and will regulate and monitor the CMH. We want to make sure that the CMH will carry out its mission as a promoter of CM in Hong Kong. As to the timetable, we'll be working hard. Generally speaking, if you want to construct a hospital, if you bear in mind the experience of the hospital authority, it will easily take you 10 years. But then for the same age, we are having a very unique arrangement. While we are having the tendering exercise, we have already started the design of the hospital itself. In other words, we believe that we can finish the mission in 6 months' time. Of course, it will be subject to a number of factors as to whether we can get it ready, up and running, end of 2024 or beginning of 2025. The first would be the epidemic Of course, we are seeing some light. Let's hope that it won't impact upon the development of the CMH. Second, the Finance Committee's funding process. It is a factor of uncertainty. We hope that once we have secured the funding, we can start the construction process. It will take us a little bit more than 3 years to complete the construction. So, should there be any delays in the funding process, then the commissioning of the CMH will also be affected. The third factor would be the question of inclement weather. Currently, for the time being, we're still optimistic. We're still working towards the target of commissioning it end of 2024 or beginning 2025. Do you have an estimate of the cost? Well, it is a tendering exercise. We have to wait for the bids to be returned. What about referrals in the future? Will the government refer cases to the CMH? And what about the division of labor between the CMH as well as the CM clinics? Have you started the dialogue? We have got some ideas and we have had rounds of consultation. So we have already developed a rough framework. In future, for the CMH, it isn't a standalone hospital. It is going to become part of the network, which has got the 18 clinics as well. So there will be the flow of information, flow of talents, and flow of patients between the hospital and the clinics. It will also be a training base for the clinics. And it is hoped that the hospital will also have a influence on the clinics. And for the clinic patients, if they need to be hospitalized, then they can be referred to the hospital. And we hope that we can sort of take on board the private practitioners in the CM market. And they can also refer their patients to the hospital. That's within the CM. And for Western medicine sector, again, they can also refer patients to the CMH. Patients, doctors, and other healthcare workers can consider referring appropriate cases to the CMH. For the CMH, we don't just have pure Chinese medicine. We have also got the integrated Chinese and Western medicine. If no other members would like to ask questions, I'll ask a question. What about the division of labor between the CMPs and the nurses? I want to know whether it will be similar to that in the case of Western medicine. Will nurses be supporting the CMPs? Well, currently, CMPs work on their own in the community. So the role of nursing isn't that sort of important. But in future, within the CMH, nurses will play an important role. As to what role they will play, of course, nurses have got their own portfolio. Whether they support the Western medicine doctors or the Chinese medicine practitioners, I'm sure this can be done. In fact, what worries us most is about the training of nursing staff for CM. We have yet to find out how we can achieve the objective. We hope that we can make use of the Chinese Medicine Development Fund to work along this direction. We understand that there are advocates for CM nursing. In other words, first of all, we need to design a course program for CM nursing. And then we can tell what sort of theories, skills would be needed. So first of all, we have to drop the curriculum. And then it means that perhaps at the existing nursing schools, we can introduce this additional element, or we can run certain advanced courses for registered nurses to enroll. And then in this way, we can drop a team of nurses for the CMPs.
Professor Lee, please. Thank you, Chairman. I'm quite confused. I'm not talking about the progress of Pokhoi Hospital. Just now, what Mr. Cheung said, I don't know whether he's a little bit off touch. Maybe he was retired and then he became the project director, so maybe he was a little bit off touch. Actually, there is a Chinese medicine nursing course in the CUHK and also in nursing schools. Because of the need for nurses, they have been teaching the nurses about Chinese medicine concepts. During the 5 years of training for general nurses, they have actually introduced an element about the concept of Chinese medicine, although there are not a lot of teaching hours concerning that. I don't understand why Dr. Cheung is telling us about the special caring nursing team of Chinese medicine. Of course, I'm not as familiar about it as Dr. Cheung, but it seems that if I understand it correctly, the Chinese Medicine Hospital will be run with Chinese medicine as the predominant methodology. Unlike foreign countries, in Hong Kong, Chinese medicine nurses do not have nurses' license. For the 2 years postgraduate course provided by the Open University, actually that is already a very effective program for training Chinese medicine nurses. I don't know what program can the Chinese Medicine Development Office devise to train CMP nurses. Actually, you are wasting the talents we have. Like the chairman said, we would be lucky if we have the Chinese Medicine Hospital in 5 or 8 years. Actually, with the current programs we have for training nurses, we will have a core group of talents in a few years, at least 200 to 300 of them. We will hire them as registered nurse or other positions. That's another problem. It just doesn't work if you only start thinking about training these talents now. Although if we don't have Chinese medicine nursing service, we are already providing Chinese medicine services to patients. There are already two batches of graduates serving in the private sector's Chinese medicine clinics. I don't know about whether the remuneration package you provide is attractive enough, but it simply doesn't work if you are only telling us that you are only now starting to think about programs to train CMP nurses. You'll be wasting the private sector's training efforts. Actually, as far as I know, there are Chinese medicine teachings provided to the registered nurse to be combined with the Western medicine trainings they have received. I think that would not be a problem. I think it's not difficult to find someone experienced enough to train the talents. Even when these nurses are working in the hospital authority, the ultimate goal is to serve the public. So I've spent 4 minutes talking about what I want to say, but I simply want to say your office should be aware that there are these nursing talents in the private sectors. Don't waste them. They are already serving patients. It's just that they are not playing an official role in the Chinese medicine hospital. We do have these talents to promote the Chinese medicine development. It's simply a waste if you ignore these talents. I absolutely agree with what Professor Lee said. There's a part There's a group of nursing talents in Hong Kong who have received postgraduate Chinese medicine training. This group of people is very vital to the development of the Chinese medicine hospital. But maybe due to the special setting of a Chinese medicine hospital, maybe we need to introduce some advanced courses. We need to study before we can come up with a timeline. And also, in terms of the CMP nursing services provided by the Chinese medicine hospital, there are going to be more developments. For those existing nursing talents, we absolutely welcome and we will enlist the help. Sorry, I want to interject. Of course, I welcome what you said. But I hope the project director and also the undersecretary would pay attention that you should make reference to my suggestion that you can learn from the practical basis and also the training provided by the current Chinese medicine nursing courses to improve the clinical environment of the Chinese medicine hospital. But so far, I cannot see the nursing regime is any different with the nursing training provided by the Open University. Those talents are receiving clinical training overseas as well. And in the mainland too. I don't see anything special in terms of nursing in the provided by the Chinese medicine hospital, which is not available elsewhere. So I'm a little bit confused about that. Thank you. We will take note of Professor Lee's view. Ms. Helena Wong, please. The Democratic Party has been very supportive of the development of the Chinese medicine hospital. And of course, what Professor Lee said is true. In terms of training Chinese medicine talents and giving them a professional status, the government should work hand in hand with them. We have been receiving a lot of worried comments from the CMP industry. We have 10,000 CMP on the scheduled. Actually, the number of CMPs are similar to that of Western medicine doctors. But it seems that in terms of recognizing their professional status and in terms of training, even for those graduates from local Chinese medicine degrees and also opportunities of practical training, there are still a lot of issues to be handled. Now you are giving 10 NGOs, you're handing the operation of 18 Chinese medical centers for training and research to 10 different NGOs. So is there any problem with that model of operation? Have you got to know or conduct a research as to what problems are being faced by the industry and what you need to do to tie in with the development of the Chinese medicine hospital? Dr. Zhang, please. Thank you for your question. First, the preparation work of Chinese medicine hospital is already being carried out. With the use of the Chinese Medicine Development Fund, we have been preparing for the establishment of the Chinese Medicine Hospital. Maybe my colleagues will tell you more about the role played by the dedicated fund. But in terms of training, we have made it clear that training would be one of the key role played by the CMH. Of course, we have a lot of locally trained Chinese medical practitioners, so they are academies and organizations set up by these practitioners, and they can provide courses in the future Chinese medicine hospital. And there have been collaboration with the mainland Chinese medicine industry in terms of enhancing training provided to our local CMPs. So Ms. Wong can tell us more about the 18 Chinese medicine clinics cum training and research centers. Besides reform of services, actually there are more other reforms concerning the clinical operation. Ms. Wong, please. Thank you, Chairman, for your question. We have $500 million in the dedicated fund to help development of Chinese medicine industry. And there are supporting programs for Chinese medicine practitioners. We have two programs under the fund. First, the Industry Support Fund. We have a program to facilitate subsidizing training for talents, the B11 plan. The cap of the fund is 2.75 million. The fund will be used to develop courses for CMPs to deepen their Chinese medicine knowledge. We have already approved some courses and rolled out these courses. There have been calls among the industry, for example, a mentorship program. Actually, we are in support of that. It is very vital to provide clinical mentorship to the graduates in order to bridge the gap between academic studies and clinical practice. Actually, this program has been approved, so they will be rolled out in the coming few years. Besides these major programs for the industry, we also provide subsidies to CMPs to enroll in courses. For example, postgraduate courses with certification in order to improve their expertise. Second round questioning by Professor Li.
Well, I don't know much about Chinese medicines, but then we have got the CM pharmacists. There are quite a number of them, and they play an important role. So my advice is that when you set up the CMH, please don't get a Western medicine pharmacist to oversee CM drugs. In fact, in Hong Kong, we do have such a group of people, but regrettably, they haven't got any regulatory framework. They can't get themselves registered. But in fact, they have already gone through the qualification process on the mainland. So in fact, it is a waste of talents. Maybe they are doing dispensing work at the CM clinics, but I believe that you need to give recognition to such CM pharmacists. Today, they get paid so poorly that it is a shame. They get only $10,000 a month despite getting a degree. So it is a waste of talents. Chinese medicines would be an important part in Chinese medicine work and the CMH. So I would suggest that you should sort of make reference to the CM regulation and try to regulate the CM pharmacists just like the Western medicine pharmacists. This way you can attract new talents. Otherwise, in 10, 20 years' time, you are going to have a headache at the dispensary of the CMH. I think they made a submission to you, but nobody has taken on board their concerns. So I think you take this opportunity to give recognition of their qualifications so that they have a good job prospect. And in this way, they will have opportunities to realize their potential. All right, Dr. Chen, please. I would like to thank the member for his question. Well, in fact, the government is studying the matter. that is qualifications, academic background, job description, etc., matters being discussed and studied by us. Under the CM Development Fund, we have also entrusted the academic organizations to study the matter on our behalf so that we can follow up the recommendations. Dr. Choi, well, indeed, we have given thought to the idea. As Professor Lee has said, we understand that herbal medicine would play a very important role. It isn't just a matter of dispensing. There's also an element of preparing the medicine, whether in the form of pills, etc. So it is hoped that we can have some breakthrough development in the coming years. All right, Dr. Helena Wong. Well, in fact, I'm also concerned about the point raised by Professor Lee. Now, the government is saying that they are going to consider the professional development of the CM pharmacists. I want to know when you're going to complete your study. Yes, Dr. Ng, please. Thank you. I'd like to thank the member for her question. Well, we have the CM Development Fund. So other than the so-called B11 scheme, we have also got the subsidy for R&D with a cap of $2 million. We'd like to encourage a study on the future career development of the CM professionals. Well, we are awaiting the collection of the funding by the research organization. It will take a year or two's time. It depends on the progress. Upon completion of the research, a research report will be submitted to the government for the reference by the government as well as the industry. In other words, you are saying that without the findings of the study, you would not know how to drop the qualification requirements for CM pharmacists. So without the study, you are not able to sort of give professional status to this group of people. Well, for the CM Development Fund, we would like to help the development of Chinese medicine and Chinese medicine drugs. So we would like to collaborate with the organizations involved in this regard. They don't just carry out academic exercises. In fact, they have to go to the field. They have to find out from the practitioners as to what this is all about, and they need to have discussion with the stakeholders. The government will also take part in the dialogue, so it is going to be complementary. So we can only expect the report in a year or two's time, right? Well, as Dr. Ng has said, after they have taken up the offer of funding, then they will start the work. It is believed that they can complete the study in a year or two's time. Let me have another go at the following question. Whether we are confident in the quality of the Chinese herbal medicine would also be crucial to the development of CM. I want to know if there is a department that can tell us the following. That is, for the quality of imported Chinese herbal medicine, do you have a testing mechanism? Not too long ago, I carried out a test and it was found that heavy metals, sulfur, pesticides were found to be of an excessive quantity. And there are also confusions over whether a plant should be regarded as food or as a herb with medicinal uses. Now, for the Chinese herbal medicines imported not via GMP arrangements, what can we do? And then probably the CMRTs, they might have been importing the GMP drugs. But what about the rest? How can we be sure that the proprietary CMs as well as the Chinese herbal medicines are of good quality? Well, in fact, at our next meeting, we are going to have a discussion of the regulatory regime for Chinese herbal medicines and proprietary Chinese medicines and development of the industry. We can have a more detailed discussion next time. Who from the team can take this question? Dr. Wang, please. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Wang, for her question. Well, in fact, we are also concerned about the regulation of Chinese herbal medicines in the market. We have a mechanism to test the substances. In Hong Kong, under the CM Ordinance, we have the Chinese Medicine Council, under which there is a particular group that is the CM Board to oversee the Chinese medicines. And regularly, we have been collecting samples. In the past, for the years 2017-2019, well, in fact, the pass rate was high. Only 0.4% of the samples failed. And for proprietary Chinese medicines, again, the failure rate was low, 0.1%. We won't be complacent. We have been monitoring the development very closely. I have a question as well. That's about the CM pharmacists. Well, for the past few meetings, we have had a number of questions raised. That is, it is hoped that we can have registration and regulation of this group of practitioners. Now, we are going to have $500 million for the purpose of research and study. Would it be taken up by the government or by organizations? And what about the status of the outcome? Would it be dismissed just like any other submissions made by deputations here? Who will take this question? Well, under the Chinese Medicine Development Fund, we have some priority topics for research. We are receiving suggestions from the industry. Well, of course, academic organizations or research organizations can come up with their ideas, but it is also an interactive process. The government will certainly liaise with the research organizations relating to the scope of the research. Once they are ready with their findings, the government will certainly study the findings, and it will be a very important element for our consideration for the way forward. Well, for the CM Development Fund, it is for the industry. However, it appears to me that the government itself is using the money. Why can't the money come from the general sort of account? Why would you need to set up this fund and yet the government is using it itself? Well, with such a fund, it means that different organizations, units, both from the research organizations as well as the industry, they can sort of participate in the development. Well, you can sort of justify it in any way you like. But then I suppose the money should be given to the industry instead of getting the government spending the money available under the fund. So I hope that you will embrace the advice instead of just dismissing the findings as some recommendations from the community. All right, any other questions? If not, then we are at AOB. Date of the next meeting, if I may sort of consult your comments. We do have two items for our next meeting. Regulatory regime for Chinese herbal medicines and proprietary Chinese medicines and development of the industry, as well as the development of the Government Chinese Medicine Testing Institute. We're supposed to receive deputations at our meeting on the 24th of February, but then we were not able to do so as a result of the epidemic. We would also like to find out more about the services of the Chinese Medicine Centers for Training and Research, the Integrated Chinese and Western Medicine Inpatient Services, as well as the GCMTI. Again, we're not able to carry out the half-day visit because of the outbreak of the virus. We have yet to find out what we are going to do. So for both the visit as well as the public hearing to receive deputations, we have to make other arrangements. After the meeting, the Secretariat will liaise with the administration to decide on the date of our next meeting. Once that's decided, we will notify you in due course. If you haven't got anything else under AOB, I will adjourn the meeting. Thank you.